Yeah, it's GT here for another YouTube video. And today, I just wanted to go back to my three pillars series or sub-series or whatever, and inject a few more insights and basics into the subject, which may help me to get along down the road towards defining the various facets of the program against the pillars of society. Now, as I have said in previous videos, three pillars upon which our society rests are the family and religion. Most especially, and sovereignty of the individual and as a country. It's important to understand the distinction there. Now, why do I say that these are the three pillars of society? That are seemingly the object of the deception of the so-called New World Order and various modes and manners and methods with which those pillars are broken down. Well, you see, these are things which one requires or one will defend in other words, you know, are you gonna, if you got into a disagreement with somebody about, say, science or something else, well, they're not going to have feelings so deep and commitments so dear to their heart about such frivolous and the meaning and the depth of one's adherence to and belief in and defense of such things as family, you know, these people will fight to preserve and protect if indeed they were threatened. Unfortunately, through the slow process of habituation and just noticeable differences in social engineering over time and with specific purposes and agendas in hand, these three pillars have simply been chipped away and dissolved almost virtually 100%. I mean, there is some little bit of each left, but not in the ways that our forefathers and all that. In fact, what is seemingly outrageous is that they have turned our own selves against those three pillars in such a way that we think that, you know, it's okay. so a little bit about each one. Okay, well, I'm going to start with preparatory. I've already talked a little bit about this with regards to how, on a global level, the sovereignty of the nations can be broken down by presenting a problem or a zeitgeist or a paradigm shift in which there's a more overarching level of something like, for example, in my video, I use the alien agenda, which is a, you know, false flag type operation, which is planned, you know. But another thing that they use is, and this is an active program at this point, is the global level of a challenge to humanity by, for example, climate change. yeah. Well, if you look at all of the various agendas of the powers that be, their globalist agendas, and all their trade agreements, and Agenda 21, and all such manners, and the prevalence and adherence to this insane model that, you know, somehow or another, you know, Mother Earth is in danger. And, you know, my research and my backgrounding in this general avenue of discourse is that these people see us, you and me, especially, not them, but they see us as the real evil, that we are like a disease upon the earth. And, you know, if you remember the Matrix film about how the Agent Smith or whatever, he says, you know, humans are like a disease or a virus or whatever. Well, this is basically what they think. And, you know, we are destroying the world, the earth, and all this and that. And they are here to save us from ourselves and from destroying the world or whatever. When in fact, the powers that be are probably more responsible for any world destroying and world polluting than anybody else, especially with their chemicals and their pesticides and their herbicides and the genocides and all that such. Well, let's see, the thing is about sovereignty. If you are a sovereign individual and you believe that you have sovereignty and all that, well, then you're a danger to that global collectivist society, because they want to be the power and the power in your life, and they want to tell you how to rule and how to run your life and everything in it. And if you look at the globalist propagandists and their agendas and in general, that's exactly what they want to do, is rule over every aspect of your life and to tell you how to act, how to think, how to behave, you know, how your relationships are, everything else. It's just, You have no sovereignty, no personal sovereignty. And as levels go up and up, you know, as far as like national sovereignty, well, they have to destroy that so that they can incorporate their ideas and their systems of control over you personally from some nebulous position on high, whatever it might be. You know, it's a white throne kind of a thing, or an ivory tower thing. Well, the guys up there tell me I gotta do this and that, and you know, and if I'm an American, for example, and it goes against principles of which, with which I have associated my own sovereignty as an American citizen, well, then I'm not going to go along with their, you know, stuff. And, you know, so, and as far as this collectivist, communist, socialist, fascist, it's collectivist, okay? And the collectivists want us to have our sovereignty on a collective global level instead of at a national or a state or a city or a locality or an individual level or as a family. These are all types of sovereignty. And so they're interrelated, these three pillars, to such a degree that they're hard to separate one from another. But as I suggested, one way to dissolve the sovereignty of the individual and or his nationalistic sovereign nature and culture of sovereign nations is to present a global or worldwide situation and to get one to come to think in the context of being a global member of the global humanity as a group think, a social, psychological thinking process. Now, group identity is how they have pulled off quite a few of these coups in the realm of the collective, and with such things as political correctness and such odd ideas, which takes away our sovereignty, you know, as a person, as a member of a state or a county or a city or a government, a country, you see. So it's very insidious, and it's a creeping takeover. It's a slow coup. It's a slow kill. It's a slow takeover of the sovereignty. And in much the same way they've taken over, usurped, substituted, and replaced the family and the country in the same way with this globalist type of thinking. In a general global way, you know, what is a family? Well, at one time I think one could, you know, safely say, well, a family is, you know, a wife and a husband and their kids and, you know, maybe their parents and, you know, whatever, you know, multi-generational model of extended family, at least, you know, a few generations of people who, you know. But now, the way that it is. They made us as dependents upon the government for many things that were once carried out by the family. In fact, one of the biggest is probably the care of the old age or the aged and the infirm and such like that, as well as the poor and other aspects and other groups. But within the context of the family, you see, we used to be very close-knit, most, and this is, you know, quite a ways back, probably into the past. But we used to take care of each other, and we didn't have any need for Social Security and all such Ponzi schemes. But now, people go, you know, they're really not connected with their parents, they're really not connected with each other, and one of the ways in which they have alienated and destroyed the family is through the use of the feminist agenda and the victimization of different parties within the family so that they can claim to be they suggest that somebody within the family structure, and for this example it was women, were somehow the victims of repression, and that, you know, for one to assert their freedom, then they had to go against everything that culture and society has built up as the norm and the working system of the way the world runs or operates. It was, you know, it's one of those things that was taken for granted of how things are until the so-called feminist movement. And in the context of the feminist movement and other movements, there's several impinging or converging influences there. And if you look at the Communist Manifesto and the agendas of the globalist organizations like the Club of Rome, and even if you look at particular facets of different kinds of political manifestos and such, the Marxists and the Communists and the Fascists, they all have something in common in that they want to make the state the most important thing, but, and that means they have to destroy the family, and they do this through promoting promiscuity, free sex or open sex, and they also do this through, you know, the support and advent of birth control, which promotes promiscuity because there are no so-called negative effects of having multiple sexual partners. And in the same or generally same way, then they promote such things as androgyny and homosexuality, and they promote those on different fronts, but also as a means of depopulation and, you know, consumerism and all that is entwined into the whole mess. I mean, you can see that, you know, when people start talking about having kids, they say, well, you know, I can't really afford kids, and so I'm going to wait, you know, not have any for, you know, maybe I try to get 30, whenever I get ready, you know. And you see, this is another part of it, is the depopulation agenda. You know, if they can destroy marriage, and if they can destroy family, then they can keep people from having very many kids. You understand? And one has to understand that on the basis of pure statistics, you know, with everything else out, you know, aside, as a nation, or as a people, or as a group, or within a family, when a man and a woman come together and become one in the sight of God, then they have to, just to replace themselves in the world, they have to have, it's averaged out, I believe it's either 2.1 or 2.3 kids, just to replace them in the world of within the realm of population. That's just to have zero population, you see. So that means, you know, countries like Japan and many of the European countries have such a low birth rate, 1 point something or other, that they're losing population left and right, you know, and their populations are now getting aged, as they are in Japan, and rapidly upcoming the United States, so that in effect, the so-called scare that they tried to convince us was ending the world and our endangerment of the world, overpopulation, using too many resources and all that, is simply a fallacy. The Western nations are generally below zero population growth. They are declining like this. Insane rate. Whoops, there goes that idea. I guess we'll have, well, it must, okay, it's climate then. Yeah, it's got to be something. See, something global, which affects everybody, so that we can all be scared of it. Or, you know. But the destruction of the family is very important for the collectivist, because again, they want to be, you know, the leader, and they want to make sure that there isn't any source of strength for you to resist them. And sources of strength for you to resist their controlling collectivist world agenda are those three pillars. Your family. What would you fight for? What will you defend with your life? The most powerful things, the most important things in life. Your family. Your religion. Your sovereignty, both individual and as a country. Now see, the thing is, the communists, back in the, say, Marxist-Leninist period, they had convinced themselves that that the inequality of the world and the rising of the workers against their governments and all that would just occur in the case of a situation like World War I, you see. And they were wrong. See, they thought that all the workers of all those different countries would rise up against their oppressive governments in that time of war. And they thought they would rise, and they figured that, you know, they could encapsulate the entire European theater with this communist attitude. And that was really one of their big goals, of getting into that system. But it only ended up taking over a very poor, kind of backward country, Russia. You know, didn't take over these industrial or so-called Western civilized nations of Europe. When confronted with war, they became very nationalistic, and they joined up, joined their armies, and fought against anybody who came against them. You see, that's why they need to destroy sovereignty, so they won't fight against the New World Order. Okay, likewise, if you are directly attacking the family, and you have strong family bonds, then you will stick up for your family and you will fight. You understand? And in a similar manner, your religion. Now, here in the United States, in general, I'm just going to say in general because I know that everybody has their own thing going and all that. But this country was basically founded on a Protestant Christianity, and for the most part, I believe the statistics show that that's about 80% of the population, at least in their claimed beliefs and such like that. And I have done some research, and statistically, that's about what it comes out to be. So, what they have to do in case of religion is they have to corrupt it. They have to graft it in to all the other religions so that you can't retain a religious identity that you would defend if it was threatened. Well, you see, go back to the Mayak report, which was 2009, I do believe, if you can look it up, but I have some previous videos about that kind of thing. But they're attacking Christians. They're attacking anybody with any religious beliefs as extremists. And I remember seeing a video, and it was attributed that a former attorney general had said something to the effect, and I believe it was attributed to Janet Napolitano, although it may or may not be a hoax, that she said that it was it was Janet Reno, I'm sorry, that she attributed anybody who believed in the second coming of Jesus as being a cultist. Now, I can't verify that that's what exactly was said, and seemingly this is an urban legend at this point, but I remember seeing that. Anyway, but the thing is, the government is now, our government, the United States government is, you know, we're part of this globalist thing because they're trying to take us over from within. And what I'm trying to say is that they have to take that away from you. They have to separate you from your religion. And how do you do that? Well, by watering it down, I believe. The agenda that I keep seeing and that has persisted and is surfacing, the idea has surfaced for some time and is being promoted by the various agenda pushers. For example, the UN and their One World Church organization and all that, and the Pope, which, you know, all of a sudden Muslims are their brothers, and, you know, this ecumenical movement. Well, they've already signed on, the Lutherans and the Methodists and quite a few other groups, to their ecumenical movement. And that what their aim is to do is to take away Christ from your religion. In fact, you know, that's the big thing, is taking Christ out of religion. Because they're going to bring in a new Christ to take his place, you see. And, you know, this will be the Antichrist, or the Christ-like person that they are going to use to deceive everyone. Well, anyway, so Christians are especially targeted. But the rest of the people, the Catholics and all of them, you know, they're going to join in this ecumenical unity or reunification deal and essentially make it a global religion of, oh, well, everybody is really worshiping the same God, and, you know, whether or not you name it different or whatever, then it doesn't matter. It's, you know, everybody's, you know, even though they're doing different things, they're all really doing the same thing. I mean, you know, people are watered down so much nowadays in everything, you know, and they would just follow along with the beliefs and all that are implanted in their heads by TV and the media and the magazines and everything, symbolically and you know, progressively over time, until they start to believe this crap and don't fall for it. I mean, you know. So that is what seems to be the main agenda in the pillarship or whatever of religion, is this ecumenical movement, is a blending of all the religions into one, and the debasement of people, and even to the point of, you know, people being demonized for being Christians or for having morals or for having religious or you know, belief in God and all that. And, you know, they have done more than just the ecumenical movement. I mean, in general, you know, God and morality have been thrown out the baby with the bathwater, with many other things, such as the family and the promotion of promiscuity and homosexual agendas and all that, into, you know, and then this is a step-by-step process. You have to understand, it starts off breaking down the morality of the people and, you know, demotion of family values because, you know, that's the strongest pillar that we have to stand on. And if you look at the average American family, you don't have a family. You don't have the system which was set up by the Bible of head coverings or whatever. You've got God, and you've got Jesus, and you've got the husband, and you've got the wife, and then you've got the children and such. You know, each one answers to different levels along in the system. And this is the way that it was set up to be by, in biblical terms, you know, it's a hierarchy. And we are, you know, the hierarchy is set up to be such a way because that's the way that the Lord wants us to have it and to respect His laws and His ways. Well, when you break all that down and you tear the social fabric and the societal fabric such that, you know, you can't, you know, they've basically devalued men in society. And there's a secondary agenda having to do with that. And I'm going back into the family as part of the breakdown in general of society. But once you get promiscuity and freedoms and sexual freedom and all that with no consequences, then it evolves from there. Now it's the homosexual gay marriage agenda and all that. But now you see that with the acceptance, most people like 30 and under would probably say, yeah, let's go ahead and have that, you know, because for one thing, they don't have any family or moral values instilled in them, and, you know, that's our fault too. But the thing is, the next step then is, well, you know, what about these pedophiles? They like little boys and girls, and, you know, how much different is that from men liking men or women liking women? It's just a preference, right? And then, you know, you go a little bit further, and okay, well, these people like, you know, animals or what? So it's a relativism that spreads and goes out like a disease. And the ultimate goal, of course, is to have everything's okay, do as you will, and, you know. But the thing is that these are destructive to both society and to men and women inherently and internally, not just as a whole or as in global fashion, you know, if you look at. I just wanted to kind of do a short kind of another introduction or reintroduction back into the pillars of society series, and I'm going to be probably working on the impact of feminism and other such things on the breakdown of the family and society as a whole next. The family, the religion, and the sovereignty of the person is being usurped, broken down, chipped away. Every generation, every year, put a little bit more pressure and just slowly achieve the goals they want to achieve. At this point, you look at the world, you know, even though a lot of people, 70-80% of people claim to be Christians and stuff, you don't see it in the morality of the world or the society. A lot of people, you know, claim to be, you know, for family values and such, but you know, they believe in feminism and women's rights and all that, and you know, and I'm not going to go into that right now, but the attitudes that have been ingrained in our heads through propaganda by the big money people, and remember, this is always associated with all these changes, is somebody's making money off of it. Well, who makes money off the breakup of a family? Well, you know, when you got two people and they can't stay as family because it's, you know, it's not really subsidized by the state and the society anymore, well, then they have to split up, you see. And most marriages end in, I'd say the majority do, end up splitting up, and people have fewer children, and there's single-parent families, and that promotes economic hardship, dependence upon the government, and...
It's 6 o'clock.
Guess what? If the women work and the men work, well, now instead of just one person as a tax base, you got two. Who would think, you know? Who would think? And you know what? They only pay women about, you know, 80 to 85% of what they do men. So, right off the bat, you got about a 15-20% cut in your labor costs. Yeah. Think about it. Who's the man? Who's the tax man? Who's getting the money? Really, it's not going to the government, so don't think that. It's going to the banksters that own the government. The fascist, socialist, collectivists, which are really banksters. And eventually I'll get around to doing something on them too, because really they're the root of the whole system. Well, that's all I got to say about today. I want to wish everyone peace, love.